hurts. Well, members from the pro-establishment camps will never say anything that would harm the government. Mr. Luk Chung Hong. Thank you, President. We have the Secretary for Labor and Welfare yesterday. When I listened to your speech in response, you said wealth disparity is improving in Hong Kong for the workers in the lowest 10th percentile after the introduction of the minimum wage. They're doing better than the rest. So the wealth gap has narrowed. That's true. But are we making a lot of progress because of that? I hope the Secretary will not be complacent. In the report on competitiveness by the World Economic Forum, we rank number 7. We get 0 mark for labor. You may not be happy about this. You may think that you have been wronged or you have been mistreated. I hope this will not affect your confidence. Maybe giving you 0 mark is not at all fair. But Hong Kong is an economically advanced economy. Our labor protection lags behind others to a significant extent. I hope the government should recognize this. The Gini coefficient is 0.539, which is still very high. When we went to Beijing, Mr. Han Zheng mentioned the deep-rooted conflicts is because of the unfair distribution of wealth. Labor rights lay the foundation of social justice and social progress. So I want to cheer you up, Mr. Secretary. Well, you are not yet you have not yet warmed up to the job. I hope very soon you would give out the goodies that you can offer to employees. Let me talk about a number of the measures proposed. We welcome the improvement to the government outsourcing arrangement. This has been much criticized. We are saying that the government is taking the lead to be an unscrupulous employer. It only affords a contract to the lowest bidder. It takes the lead in shedding responsibility as an employer. And we have seen many cases whereby SP and LSP are not paid, and the working environment is poor for those workers. And all the problems can be attributed to the government. At this time, you say that you are going to change the ratio of the weighting of technical and price to 50 to 50, although we have said that it should be 70 to 30. And the score for labor rise offered by the contractor will be 25% of total, or 12.5% of the total. And there are also other requirements and additional pay for workers who are required to work when the number 8 typhoon signal is hoisted. The FTU has been striving to improve the employment conditions of outsourced contractors. There are more than 50,000 such workers. We have been doing various things to try to get more, including the motion passed by this council on the need to carry out an immediate review of the outsourcing system. And we have dealt with a number of labor disputes involving housing department, Po Tat Estate, Onyam Estate, and there are other cases involving FHD, LCSD, and other statutory bodies as well, such as hospital authority and airport authority. Still, these improvements can be made even better. The point is the government must change its mindset. when we asked that that new contract should offer pay not lower than that in the old contract. Well, the government said this will mean that we don't have any outsourcing contract. Why can't it be done? There are departments which can do it. The transport department also to offer outsource contracts for cross harbour tunnel operations. And there's a provision saying that the pay under the new contract should not be lower than that under the old contract. So the department can do it. I hope the government can take this on board in the review so that there's better protection for workers of contractors. This would demonstrate the commitment to protect contractors or workers, because we have been saying that you cannot delegate, you cannot outsource your responsibility. And as a responsible government, you shouldn't do that. In the long run, the government should reduce the practice of outsourcing. If you have to do so many things in managing the outsourcing system, why don't you employ them, employ these workers themselves? And then people can make some comparison. In, for example, you can have that non-technical staff managing parks and other facilities. Then people may be able to make a comparison or whether the one is better doing a better job than the others. Or you may think that you can save on pay, but the difference is not much. And the government has been saying that the outsourcing system is not there to save money. Since that's the case, please actively look into the possibility of reducing outsourcing of government work. We ask for 1.5 time of pay if the worker has to be on duty during a typhoon. But after a typhoon, it would be the workload would be very heavy. So maybe the pay should be higher. And also, most workers would certainly like to work in the same district. When there's a change of contractor, they may then work for another contractor. But in their mind, they are working for the same government. But this switch of employers will affect their seniority and their length of service, and it will also affect their entitlement to annual leave. So perhaps some compensation can be provided in the contract that they have with employers or the contractors. That is, let me turn to the cancellation of MPF offsetting mechanism. Well, actually, Ms. Chen Yunhan back then asked for the scrapping of this arrangement when it was first proposed. There are people from the business sector standing in the way, and they are also trying to scare people by misleading people and try to use the different concept to scare people, such as saying that a provision is an expenditure.
Nothing is perfect. There is always room for improvement. Of course, we will always welcome any improvement. Most important thing is that it's to be done early. Every year, we spend over $36 billion in the offsetting mechanism. So if it is delayed by 1 year, billions of dollars will be offset from employees' account. I ask the administration to introduce the bill in 2019 for first readings and second reading. I believe that there is sufficient vote to pass this bill. I believe that there won't be any legislators who will unreasonably delay it. I don't want this to be pushed to the next government. This is the duty of the last government. CY Leung finished half of it. This government will complete it. There is no reason why we should wait for another term of government. I hope that you will step on it so that we can see the result. Please do not delay anymore. The business sector should not get in the way. After the abolition of the offsetting mechanism, there are still a lot of problems with the MPF. To name a few, high administrative fees, progress of launching of EMPF. Are there any ways to regulate trustees to reduce their fees? Hong Kong is an international financial center. However, when it comes to administration charges for retirement funds, it's the highest in the world. We are an international financial center. This is one of our expertise. Why would our fees be one of the highest? It really beats me. I know that there will be the review of the DIS. I hope that it will be done as soon as possible. For the default investment strategy, DIS, yes, fees have been driven down. However, the average is still 0.9%, which is on the high side. If the fees are reduced, then return will increase. After that, there should be full portability of the MPF. This will give more flexibility. This will also promote healthy competition, which will in turn drive down fees and improve return. We have over $1 trillion of reserve. Well, people who support reclamation and infrastructure will need to show the same commitment to retirement protection. You need to consider an integrated retirement protection scheme proposed by the FTU. We think that annuity is good, OALA is good, but they can't replace a retirement system that is non-means tested and based on rights. This is a fundamental protection. We don't want to penalize people who have financial discipline, who have saved a bit and can't get OALA. For the third area, I would like to talk about OSH, Occupational Safety and Health. It's touched on in the policy address, for example, increase of rehabilitation and treatment services. There will be case management and to enhance law enforcement. For the support services, there will also be more effort put into cases with disputes. We have received a lot of claims cases. That means employers refuse to admit liability. The Employees' Compensation Ordinance protects, supposedly, employees. However, it can only be done with the consent of the employer, and the employer will have to admit liability before the Labor Department issue a notice to follow up on leave subsequent to injury at work. However, some employers deny that the injury is sustained at work. The employee can't get paid, can't go to work, will have to go to the labor department. The department doesn't have power to arbitrate. And they try to negotiate with employers. However, there is little they can do. I understand that labor officers work very hard. But employers simply are not scared of them. In the end, they will have to go to the court. So they will have to go through long legal proceedings. They are subject to tremendous psychological and physical pressure. It's not fair to people who suffer injuries at work. Sometimes, even when they win the case, there won't be any additional punitive sentencing. If you get an award, employers can drag their feet for a few months. So employers who like to take advantage of employees will ignore these cases because they know that the employees would not easily go to the court. So you do need to give the give an arbitration power to the labor department. This will be a simple mechanism, something that is easier than having to go to the court. And at the moment, the penalty is too light. Well, according to the script written by my colleague, it says that it's a slap on the wrist. Let me refer to the information supplied by the administration. In 2017, violation of the Employment or Compensation Ordinance, the each summons will result in a fine of $10,500. OSH violations is very serious. It's peanuts compared to a huge amount of projects. For fatal cases, the penalty is only about 21,000. We're talking about someone's life. I know that the administration is aware of the problem, but what about progress? When will the law be changed? There's also liability for the industry and undertakings, factory undertakings ordinance. There is a huge loophole. You will have to prove that there is deliberate negligence before you can send the employer to jail. It's not easy. It's a tall order. We ask the administration to plug the loophole, and as soon as possible within this government, introduce legislative amendments. We hope that rehabilitation should also be included in the ECO. Well, now there is compensation four-fifths of your wage or $300. We know that the Labor Department and the insurance sector launch a voluntary rehabilitation scheme, which, as the name suggests, is voluntary. Some people are concerned that if they participate in the program, then they'll be forced to cancel their sick leave. Employees need additional resources to receive rehabilitation services because shortly after you've sustained an injury, it's a very good time for you to receive treatment and rehabilitation service. And I think that the setting up of a central occupational compensation fund is also a good idea. Sometimes the employer-employee relation may not be a conventional one, so we need something with flexibility. There is also a need to review employers' responsibility when employees suffer occupational diseases. I've already covered that. For lower limb wear and tear, well, the policy address mentioned about measures to be implemented to help employees who have to stand in their line of work and as a result suffered injury. For people in the sales business or service industry, they have to be on their feet the entire day. The guidelines themselves are good, but enforcement will have to be in-depth and comprehensive before employees are protected. Our OSH Association has conducted a survey. The findings are that those people who have to be on their feet the whole day suffer injuries to different degrees, and it's proof that being on one's feet is not good for for your vascular system. There are employees who suffer from occupational disease, and these diseases are not incorporated on the list when it comes to varicose veins. They should be included. The guideline doesn't cover types of work that require people to stand for a long time, say for example teachers, ground crew, chefs. We also ask the Labour Department to prosecute employers if they do not put in place measures to assist employees under the ECO. I hope that a clearer guideline regarding types of work that require one to be on their feet to be clearer. There should also be a rest time specified. People in retail industry, you don't have to stand to show that you are courteous. You can still sit down and chat with your customers and a business can still be done. Maybe it's just that they think that standing up is the best. So people who work in these trades will be on standing upright from the time when they start work to when they finish. There are also a number of other illnesses relating to your feet, your varicose veins, and fatigue in your lower limbs. I hear that a lot of members have talked about Lantau Tomorrow Vision. I support that. I'm from the labor sector. I think the investment into Lantau Tomorrow Vision will not be taken from welfare, healthcare or education. If one tells you that, they're lying to you. Well, you may spend hundreds of billions of dollars on reclamation. Of course, you will make a profit from it. And I also see that this is a comprehensive development project. It will provide, it will create 340,000 jobs. This will be conducive to diversification of employment.
Talking about benefit for the labor force, it's not just the job, it's not just protection by the law, but after doing very hard work, what is most important to them is a home, so that you have incentive to work more. From the angle of economic impetus, the fire in our heart would mean that we need upgrading of the industries, we need more space in the community, and for living, we need land so that we can see hope. we need large pieces of land. You can talk about farmland, brownfield sites, all those are important, but we must adopt a multi-pronged approach. If the administration can show this kind of resolve, I am very comforted indeed. In some terms of government, they turned away from problems, and the last term was that it had the intention to do something, but it did not have the ability. But this time around, you have the determination, you also have the capability, and you dare eat into the interests of property and land conglomerates. And when the administration can create its own land, the conglomerates will not be able to call all the shots, and the administration will be able to sit down and bargain with the developers. And therefore, there will be this ability to bargain on the side of the administration. And just because of this point, I think it is already worth a while to vote yes to the vote of thanks. Thank you, Mr. Ben Chan. Thank you, President. President, in terms of medical services, I'd like to say a few things, and I'd like to also take the opportunity to talk to the Secretary about Chinese medicine. First of all, in the policy address this time around, it is said that Chinese medicine will be given an actual recognition and status in Hong Kong's medical system. I was so happy to see that Chinese medicine will be recognized in the public medical delivery system. But then when I looked closer, it was said that it would not be recognized as a part of the medical delivery system, but as a part of the development of Hong Kong's medical system. Well, Chinese medicine has always been part of the medical system, so why do you need to give it extra recognition again? It has always been a part of our medical system. All these years, the Chinese medicine sector has been striving for a status for Chinese medicine in the public medical system. But now you have again resorted to vague terminology in the PA, and this is a little confusing. And it seems you are steering clear of the term of public medicine. I then knew that I had no reason to rejoice. And then I told that to the Chinese medicine sector. And then when I cooled down, I know that there has not been much progress. I don't know whether you have other plans in mind, but I'd like to take the opportunity to tell the administration that at present, what we need most for our medical system is manpower. Very often, Chinese medicine can be the solution. According to the FH Bureau, in 2016, 9,900 Chinese medical practitioners are registered, including 7,262 are registered Chinese medicine doctors, and the rest, the remaining, are listed Chinese medical practitioners, and that would be 2,640. As for doctors in Western medicine, 50% of them are in the public system. Now, how many of the Chinese medical practitioners are there? And there is only 12%. In other words, you can allow more CMPs to be included so that we can shorten queues in the public medical system. In other words, there is a large group of people with medical knowledge whose resources are not tapped into. Every year, we have Chinese medicine students who have read Chinese medicine on the mainland or in Hong Kong universities, and they need to find a job after graduation, and it has been difficult for them. In the PA, the administration said that you would subsidize certain Chinese medicine services, including even hospitalization services and outpatient clinics. There will be some subsidy. In fact, you are subsidizing outpatient clinics already. It is good for you to increase the subsidy, but yet we still do not see a role for Chinese medicine in the public medical delivery system. I hope the Secretary can give us a clearer account when the opportunity arises. What kind of status does Chinese medicine enjoy in the public medical system? We have to be very careful about the terminology that you are using. Please look at this plaque. We want public Chinese medicine service. Now, when you pay a visit to CMP, you may pay $100 consultation fees, and you pay several hundreds for medicine. And then if you visit a Western practice doctor at OPCs, it's less than $100. So actually, Chinese medicine is quite expensive. Secondly, I'd like to talk about the cervical cancer vaccination. It is said that primary five students will receive the first cervical cancer vaccination in 2019-2020. And then when they come to primary six, they will receive the third jab. I support this. I really appreciate it. Because amongst the different cancers, cervical cancer is the one that can be prevented by the receiving of a vaccination. The infection will be prevented, and there will be a much lesser chance of contracting the disease. This time around, you are benefiting primary five students. What about those in primary six? They will not be included. What about those in secondary one? They are not included in the present program. The DAB will suggest that hopefully you can enhance or optimize the cervical cancer vaccination scheme. How do you do that? In the academic year 2019-2020, you should allow all school students to receive the first vaccination up to primary five. And then next year, you can provide the second vaccination, and come the third year, you will just give the vaccination to primary five students, and then you can go on from there. So that those who are in primary six will also benefit, because some parents may like to take their children to private doctors. Sometimes there is a lack of supply, and sometimes they need to pay a lot for it, and then after the first vaccination, they may not benefit from the second vaccination, again because of a shortage of supply. Therefore, I hope that this subsidy scheme for cervical cancer vaccination can cover all students in primary and secondary schools, so we can protect all students. Number three, I'd like to talk about the shortage of supply of medical staff and their work conditions. We believe that the majority of staff in the public system are working in a very proactive manner. But then, in the system, what we see is that those hospitals which do not perform well will be shunned, but those who perform well are very much popular with the public. So those who do not perform well do not have a high workload, while those who perform well will have the workload ever increasing. And it has resulted in a very unfair mechanism phenomenon, in that if you work well, you have to work overtime. That is, of course, what we have always been saying, in that those who are capable will always have a high workload. But now the situation is, if you are capable, you work too much, you overwork. And then these staff may want to go into the private sector, and then the remaining ones will have to take up and share the workload. And this is the vicious cycle. This is not what the public want to see. I believe those who work in the public medical system have already secured their professional recognition, therefore they must be very capable. And what matters more, I think, is the work attitude. And that is whether you apply yourself to the job. And that has to be encouraged. We are not asking you to launch a punitive system. Rather, to allow our medical staff to be even more enthusiastic, you should put in place an award scheme to improve their remuneration, tell them that if they work better, they will be rewarded, they will be having more promotional prospects, so that we can improve the situation where the capable overwork. If these people who work hard and who are capable are paid more, are given promotion, then they will be willing to remain in the public system, and then we will not have a shortage of manpower. Therefore, we must break this vicious cycle. You have to face up to this shortage of manpower in the public system. You should start some pilot schemes. You should provide some recognition scheme by awarding those who work hard. Now, of course, this will require money. So, Secretary, I hope you can inject positive energy into the public medical delivery system so the public can enjoy better medical service. Okay, what cannot be taken up by the public system? What happens to that part? I have said many times that we should go to for public-private participation. It's just like the care for the eye. I remember those waiting for cataract surgery have to wait very, very long. And then, well, after we have had PPP, elderly people who undergo cataract operation did not have to wait that long. That scheme has been working so well that I hope you will extend it to include other aspects of eye care. The queuing time now is already quite serious. The general cases will have to wait 52 weeks, and the serious ones, they wait 114 weeks. And if you say, well, that is not the case for urgent cases, but then a general practice doctor will receive a patient who has an eye problem, and then he writes a referral, and then the patient takes the reference letter to queue up for specialist care, and then they will have to wait 114 weeks, and the disease will deteriorate, like glaucoma or a problem with the retina. And then their situation will deteriorate. Therefore, I hope that you can start a PPP for eye care, and so that you can extend this very good scheme. When the situation is good, you think eye doctors will go into the private sector, but in fact, that is not the case. If they do not have so many cases and they are not so pressured for time, they work in a better environment, and then they will have more incentive to stay in the public system. Therefore, what we like to see is that we should help the medical staff in our public system so that they will remain in the public system. And I was referring to the Bright Action for Cataract Surgery Program. There are now about 30,000 doctors in the psychiatric field. As you know, we have more and more psychiatric cases nowadays. I hope the administration can consider using PPP also to treat psychiatric cases. You know, psychiatric cases cannot wait. When patients are affected, they need to be attended to, but then we do not have psychiatric service in the public system on weekends. And here is what PPP can help. Therefore, I hope that going forward, you can consider PPP for providing psychiatric service.
I have talked to groups that are interested in mental health. I will soon put in a question to ask for more information from the government. I won't elaborate on that at this moment. And then I will talk about welfare for the elderly. I did ask the CEO to look into that since we have got the Secretary for Labour and Welfare here. So I would like to speak on behalf of the elderly people in Hong Kong. I'm asking for the waiving of means testing for those aged 65 to apply for OAA. Well, it has been said that it will be too costly. However, we know that we have got a lot of money in our fiscal reserves. for somebody aged 65, you pay $2 for all public transport, and probably you would have already retired from your jobs. So what they face is that they're asked to pass the means testing. You certainly and easily would have accumulated some savings by the age of 65. I think by giving them the token OAA is a matter of showing some respect to them. Well, it's a matter of giving acknowledgement to their previous contribution. So it's a small amount of money just for tea or some fruits. Now, we do acknowledge that they would easily have a small amount of savings, but I don't think they should be denied the chance to get OAA just because they have got some savings. Today, we know that Mr. Wang Kam Sing is acting the post of Chief Secretary. I would like to talk about collection of waste as well as the charging scheme for municipal solid waste. Mr. Stephen Ho just now stood up to speak, and he said that there was a mount of waste measuring 2 meters tall. I tried to verify what he had said. Now, can you see it? Well, I took a photograph of what was stacked outside his house. It is indeed 2 meters tall. Mr. Ho is a tall guy, but then the pile of rubbish is also tall and even taller than him. He lives in the rural area. Many more people have moved to the rural areas, but then our waste collection network is not adequate for the rural areas. I understand that we have a smart collection, we have compacting services for the rubbish collected. Well, the other day we called a press conference. The I read engineering. I was trying to see if I can think of a solution to improve upon the smart waste collection system. I'll just see if I can make any proposals later on. Now, Mr. Wong, you are the acting CS. I have to make this point. I understand that very soon we're going to have the charging scheme for waste disposal. I don't think I have the confidence to say that I can support you. Secretary or CS, please take a look at this photograph. It's been taken earlier on, and then subdivided unit tenants moved out, and then they just dumped their rubbish on the rooftop because it's easier to go to the rooftop than go a few floors downstairs to dump the rubbish on the street. Now, you see a number of refrigerators on the rooftop. I dare not open the refrigerators. You have also got washing machines and other types of household waste. Now, you see that in the urban area on rooftops, we see such piles of waste. In the rural area, again, with piles of rubbish. I just don't know whether we can enforce the law. What worries me is that before we have a sound recycling system, we have to overcome the problems that come with the waste charging scheme. Well, if it is easy to dump our rubbish anywhere, then probably the next time Mr. Ho raises this issue with you, maybe he can't even go out. Maybe the path outside his house would have been entirely blocked by the rubbish dumped on the footpath. So I think you have to think of feasible strategies and plans. Now, you have to make sure that you have waste collection, waste recycling before you put in place the charging scheme for municipal solid waste. Before that is in place, I'm afraid I may not be able to say that I support your legislative amendment.
prove to us that this is proper. We are not saying that we would object to anything to be suggested by the government. But I have to point out that the waste collection system as well as the waste recycling system must be proper before we can embark on such a charging scheme. Otherwise, we will see the waste being dumped everywhere. Ms. Yong Ho-yen, Mr. President, well, the statutory maternity leave will be increased from 10 weeks to 14 weeks. And in fact, all the civil servants starting from the 10th of October will be entitled to this benefit. I think it is a good start. I hope the administration will continue to enhance the labor rights for our female employees. And I hope that in the light of our economic development, please also extend the number of days of the fraternity leave. Now, the government has suggested that it would pick up part of the bill for the extended maternity leave. In this way, this will encourage the commercial sector to support the government's move. The government has to talk to the business sector in relation to the details, and the government has to look at the impact on the business sector. Now, for the MPF contributions, that's the issue, and then there will be the voluntary health insurance scheme, and then there will be the paternity leave enhancement. So it will add to the cost of the business sector. I think the government should come up with the figures and then talk to the business sector as to how the extra costs will be shared. Now, I would like to turn to the question of child care. Well, the policy address has got a number of measures to help with child care. Say, for example, enhancing the manning ratio for kindergartens and child care centers. And then for those aged between 3 and 6, there will be after-school care. But what about those aged between 0 and 3 years old? I'm afraid the policy address is silent on that. I hope the administration won't forget them. I met with the Protection of Children Society last month. We talked about the proposals in the policy address. We believe that more should be done to help those in the age group 0 to 3. In fact, children develop rapidly within their age range. Their care and their education will undergo a rapid process, and without the right kind of education, I'm afraid that the linguistic ability will be affected as well. So it is high time for the government to take a fresh look at our existing policies. Well, of course, childcare policy covers the age range of 0 to 6. And last year, the year before last, we had the quality kindergarten education. It appears that government is shifting the focus to those aged between 3 and 6. In other words, the resources given to 0 to 3 and 3 to 6 are very different. As of now, we have only got 12 subsidized or suspended independent kindergartens. And there are 740 day places. Therefore, just one for every 77 of them. Southern District, Islands, Kwun Tong, Tai Po, Sai Kung, etc. They don't have any day places. Many parents have said that they have to wait for over 20 months. That is until their toddlers are 10 to 20 months old before they can get a place. Of course, it is not satisfactory. It shows that there is a strong demand and the supply cannot catch up. The government must address the serious imbalance. I hope the government will continue to enhance community childcare services so as to provide more support to the working parents. The policy address has said that the manpower ratio of the child care centers will be enhanced. So what's happening is that for those taking care of 0 to 2, it will be enhanced to 1 to 6. But then such a 1 to 6 ratio is still lagging behind the other countries. The secretary has said that we're not supposed to draw any direct comparison. But still, I believe that it is but right for us to set a higher standard, a better ratio, because the Hong Kong earth do deserve a better service. It is not just a matter of enhancing the manpower. The service should be specialized and professional, and we should enhance their pay package. We should provide better and more training. Now I turn from children to the elderly. The population of Hong Kong is aging, and the demand for elderly services would only grow continuously. Now children have to wait for their place in childcare centers, and in fact on day one you have to wait for a place in the childcare center, primary school, secondary schools, etc. For the elders, again, they have to wait a long time before they get to live in a subvented home. Some of them may not survive the waiting time. Well, in fact, the waiting time is even longer than that for the young children. In fact, many elderly citizens have to take care of another elderly person at home. Sometimes it may be their elderly couple. Well, community support is inadequate. For us, the New People Party, we have met with the government. We hope that there will be a fund to be set up to take care of home care, so that even though our proposal hasn't been taken on board in the policy address, I would still urge the government to be more open-minded and try to implement our suggestion, so that elderly can age in place, and then they will be able to enjoy their twilight years. Now, I have to turn to the question of public markets. Mr. President, I think we need to check the expansion of the LEUNG. I've always been interested in this. Now, some of the shopping malls and the markets have been sold by the LEUNG, like Suntin Market, Sunchoi Market. For Suntin Wai, well, the vacancy rate is almost 100%. Well, the original storeholders have been evicted, and people doubt the future of this particular market. In the past, Sunchoi Estate used to have a market, but after the storeholders have been checked out, we no longer have a market. For Sunchoi Estate, of course, the market doesn't just serve the people in Sunchoi. A number of other private residential developments would also benefit from this market. But of course, the market is not operating, and then citizens have been advised to go to the market in Long Hang Estate. Well, in year 2009, the Hong Kong Planning Standards and Guidelines were amended. Now, I understand that the Planning Department would consider whether there is a need to build new public markets on the basis of community needs, whether there are markets nearby, either private or public. Well, we have got the Hong Kong PSG. We are supposed to follow them. But what about private operators, private developers? They won't follow the Hong Kong Planning Standards and Guidelines. Now, the government has said that it will follow the guidelines. But for a private market, if the private market is closed, there's no way that we can get it back. Now, who's going to enforce the planning standards and guidelines? Are they still the standards? When it comes to land administration, land leases, I think the planning department must re-examine how it is to be strictly enforced.
I think that is a more important thing. Well, I've outlined problems in Tai Wai. I hope that the administration will adopt a multi-purpose approach to house different uses within one building. Say, for example, a municipal complex. We have been asking for public market in a government complex. They now said that one may be constructed in Taiwan, but a public market may not be put into it. I asked the administration to put a cook food center as well as a public market inside the Taiwan municipal complex. There are a number of measures relating to public market in the policy address. Say, for example, construction of public markets in Taiwan, Tung Chung and Taiwan. I hope that in Cheung Kwan Noh and Kutung North, I ask the administration to identify sites for public markets. Please consult district councils, district bodies, and residents. Well, it's not just about one market in Cheung Kwan Noh. Cheung Kwan Noh is very large. If I go from Metropole City to Lohas Park, it takes a very long time from Metro City. So you will have to find out how many public markets we need in Cheung Kwan Noh. I support the administration's proposed adjustment of housing mix from 60-40 to 70-30 regarding public to public housing to help people move into suitable housing as soon as possible. Be it public or private housing, does it mean that you will stop at just owning a flat? I have received a lot of complaints saying that people saved hard to buy a flat. However, it's only actually the start of a nightmare. Quality of new builds is very poor. They only have to stay there for a few years. You see a number of problems, spalling, leaks, bursting of pipes, problems with windows, so they will have to keep doing snagging. They called the water leakage office, they can't find the source of the leak, and they still use old methods to test to find the source of the leak. And the administration said that there will be 3 pilot projects for the use of new technology, say for example, infrared light. So we asked the administration to use new technology to enhance their capability. I mentioned about leakage, which is the nightmare for a lot of owners. A lot of them asked me to forward their plight, to tell the secretary their plight, and to ask the secretary to help them. Well, we have heard a number of incidents involving lifts. The MSD announced that for the first half of the year, there were 5 incidents last year, 8. We have about 60,000 lifts. 80% of them don't reach the safety standard. About 30,000 of them is about 20 years old. I see that in the policy address, there is one measure to improve lift safety. Well, there is the Operation Building Bright 2.0, as well as another scheme that will be about $2.5 billion, and it will be used to improve the safety of lifts. I support it strongly. I wait eagerly for details. Regarding works that have not been completed, I hope that they will be included in the proposed program. Lifts are for private buildings, but I do see that there is serious problems with public rental housing or tenant purchase, those under the tenant purchase scheme. We talk about improving people's livelihood. We see that the happy index of Hong Kong people is rather low. Well, if I buy a concert ticket, the price is $980, but I have to pay about $10,000 for a ticket. You can improve people's livelihood starting from very small areas to make people happier. I've met with representatives of performing arts. They would like me to ask the administration to do something about ticket touts. I noticed that the UK government uses, criminalize ticket scalping using bot software. I so submit. Mr. Jonathan Ho, this is about people's livelihood. I've read the policy address. What I see, what I think is that is the rise and fall of the government. We are successful because of the Brits. They gave us civilization and an economic miracle. However, our fall is also something to do with them. Because the Brits designed the city with minimum effort and cost. So the design is that there is minimum involvement on the part of the government. Perhaps I can hear from the administration. That is the Secretary for Food and Health, because you're an expert. I haven't seen any major change. In terms of manpower planning and city planning, we see that we seriously lag behind. During the colonial days, well, it's a place for the colonial government to maximize their profit. They make a living here, they invest here, when they leave, well, the mentality of the government is still the same. I think that there is little change from 1997. How do we improve? I'd like to give you two examples. First, family-friendly policy, and secondly, elderly services. There is no change in principle. Colonial government tries to milk Hong Kong dry. They loot Hong Kong. But now, shouldn't we bear in mind the interest and well-being of Hong Kong people when we make plans? Just now, Eunice Yong said that we can't compare with overseas countries. Is it really the case? We have a low tax regime But does it mean that we can't do anything? I think the stumbling block is that we still follow an old system. And this system doesn't really care about Hong Kong people's well-being. Now, it's after reunification. We have Chinese people as government officials. Do we still use the same mentality? Hong Kong is no longer a borrowed place. Decades ago, our parents came to Hong Kong fleeing from war. They thought they would return to their birthplace. But now we have settled in Hong Kong. That's why we think that paternity leave and maternity leave is not enough, because Hong Kong is our home. Our children will be here. There are lots of places in China and other places. Well, my wife is studying in France for a PhD, for a doctorate degree. She just had over a week's holiday for Halloween. And then the 2 weeks holiday in winter, spring break 2 weeks, summer 2 months. Well, if Hong Kong people have more holidays, we will be happier. We won't be as aggrieved. Well, you don't want us to haunt you, Secretary, right? Everyone has limits, whether you are Westerner or from Hong Kong. Pursuit of happiness is important. Having a holiday is important. I'm not going to mention about menstrual leave. Well, when it comes to family-friendly policy, it stays on an encouragement level. Hundreds of enterprises joined this voluntary movement. We have hundreds of thousands of micro and SMEs, but less than 1% of them have family-friendly policies. But you have to be heavy-handed. Otherwise, no one will improve the situation. Is it because they can't do it or they won't do it? Paternity leave, why can't it be expanded? Why can't we have longer maternity leave? People aspire to have children. Don't dampen that aspiration. That is an important direction. Is there any other place? Say, for example, maybe in India. But is there another place in Hong Kong? Any other place in the world that don't encourage higher birth rate? We have an aging population. We encourage birth rate to increase our labor force and to increase our population. In Hong Kong, it is not adopted. It's because of the policy direction from the colonial days.
If you do not change that guiding principle, it will be difficult for us to extend maternity and paternity leaves. Dr. Choi, even if you're going to build a baby hospital, you do not have the complementary facilities. That is because you are following that guiding principle. I'm not saying you have not done anything. You are coming in with very slow progress. You extend maternity leave to 14 weeks, and in the land sale conditions, you require developers to provide nursing rooms. You encourage mothers to breastfeed their babies. We do see these small improvements, but if you don't change the basic guiding principle, how can we bring in more changes? If the PA written by a female CE, would we really like to work for a family-friendly environment, you have to go back and think about the guiding principles behind your policies. Don't just regard them as employee benefits. All over the world, people are working to hike the birth rate. The FTU does not object to the maternity leave proposal. This has come along after 40 years. It is a good thing that you are doing. But can you do more to encourage people to have babies? Do you want to regard giving birth as a disease? If not, why do you pay 80% only as if people are taking sick leave? Well, of course, my wife threw up when she was pregnant, but this is not a disease. People are not sick. Why do you deduct 1/5 of the salary when people take maternity leave? You may explain that that is your policy all along, but if you want to encourage a higher birth rate, you should change this principle. With regard to people who are paid $50,000 or more, well, you draw the line there. If you have $50,000 a month, you will only receive partial subsidy. But in fact, you should do more. We were saying just now that perhaps when you have the new arrangement, perhaps you can even inject more. There may be another female policy secretary who may earn $300,000 and yet she is at a childbearing age. You may ask, why should we subsidize her to have a baby while she is paid a handsome salary? However, we are talking about a principle. When we have this new maternity leave arrangement, perhaps you can consider injecting more money to pay people in full when they take maternity leave. And you may even want to bring in other kinds of subsidies to encourage people to have babies. We see that happening in other countries. And to take this further, even men who are on paternity leave should be paid in full. I'm sure the government can play the lead and then the business sector will not resist it so much. Well, of course, they will still find excuses to object to the lengthening of maternity leave. But if you really want to stimulate the birth rate, you have to tackle this upfront. We hope family-friendly measures will be taken even further. And we should not just start with financial subsidy. We hope there will be a protective period after maternity leave. I have dealt with a case in May. A female worker was sacked right after her maternity leave. This may be some kind of worry for women. If you really have the people's welfare in mind, you may want to do something about that major principle. I say that the PA may want to do a lot, but it may not achieve a lot. It is because you have followed the principle of the colonial era where you only do the minimum. And I'm really thinking about public markets. This has everything to do with people's livelihood. In this term of government, you are finally providing public markets in Cheung Kwan, Old Mao and Shan, Tin Shui Wai, and Tong Chong. Well, not one for Mao and Shan, but we hope it will be coming soon. We welcome that. But then in developed areas, there is a gross lack of market facilities. It is a very tricky issue. Well, the lease for divesting properties to LEUNG was very vague. It was very lenient in a way, so that people will be able to use legal loopholes to make profits. LEUNG is now able to further divest property to other buyers, and we can't do anything because there is no government land to talk about. The housing department's design originally was that there would be one market for an entire area. Ms. Sylvia Chan, you do not have to knit your brow. Let us think about a solution together. And now LEUNG is having a monopoly in an entire area. This is really a very big problem. Finally, the LVHD is launching a market modernization scheme. But before we see the advantages, we are seeing the downside. It is because under this scheme, the LVHD is doing this and that to old markets. Because before I talk about market modernization, let me talk about retrofitting of air conditioners. I have known this problem for over 10 years. Do you really think that AC can bring in more business? Not necessarily so. I went to an old market in Kun Tong 2 days ago. Out of 138 markets in Hong Kong, we have got 41 with AC retrofitting, and this is one of them, but it is still very silent. It is next to Shui Wa Street, but still it is not frequented by people. The stallholders know how to conduct their business, but what is happening? It is because the ombudsman made a comment, and suddenly the FEHD is so strict with enforcing the rules. That has not been done for 20 years. And I'm talking about the enforcement of tenancy conditions. Say, for example, if a stall should sell non-food dry goods, it should sell, for example, clothes, and then it also now provides alteration service. And then now it is said that it can only provide goods and not service. And then for a metal hardware shop, you should be selling metal hardware. But if you help people make keys, it is a kind of service, and they are stopped from doing so. That area or the market is already unpopular. And then it was said that if you want more freedom, if you don't want to continue with the tenancy, you can leave the market. This is what the FEHD is telling stallholders. Maybe this is because of the modernization scheme, and that is why the FEHD is taking these measures. I know old markets have been built for different reasons, but now their business is suffering. That is a fact. And the public need their service. People need to make new keys. People need to have their clothes altered. And this only shows one thing. And that is, you have been very calcified and bureaucratic in your approach. Talking about market policy, I think there is one stumbling block. As long as you do not charge AC fees, no one would object for AC retrofitting. As long as you don't charge the stallholders AC fees, no one would object, because the AC is not just used by the stallholders. You are providing service to residents as well. Therefore, you are not subsidizing the small stallholders. But even so, why can't you help them? Do you only want to help the large conglomerates? These people are small operators operating along market principles. Would that be so difficult for you? Why don't you really want to charge air conditioning fees? You have had these markets for 20 years, and yet you require an 80 to 85% agreement threshold before AC is retrofitted. Why don't you allow residents to continue to patronize inexpensive markets? I'm again talking about your guiding principles. Do you really want to have cost recovery? Is it really a kind of expenditure only? Actually, you are supporting the public. It is really a matter of your mindset and your guiding principles. Another point. The FHD is not doing an exactly good management job. But the housing department is even worse. If you look at the old housing estates, you will know what I mean. New markets have been contracted out, the rental is high, and old markets are left there if they are unpopular. But since these are government markets, why don't you deal with them together? So you provide services for the public for them to buy daily necessities. I know the policy objective of housing department markets are to serve that estate, but FEHD markets serve the entire district. However, private markets are charging very high rental, and they are driving out services which the public need. Why don't we make use of resources to consolidate government resources in order to tackle the high rentals in private markets? The acting CS for A is here, the secretaries are here. Why don't you take markets as a whole? LEUNG is divesting its property further, and because of the lease conditions, we can't do anything with LEUNG. So what can we do? Secretary, and even the director, I know you have high aspirations for our markets, but I hope the $2 billion would be put to good use. I hope you will not delay anymore. Let us relax our policies. Let us not just go for cost recovery. This is actually some good kind of spending for the public. We are serving the public, and I think if you think that way, it would go a long way in resolving many problems. Let me talk about hawkers now. In many places in Hong Kong, this is the way small operators conduct their business. In fact, the mainland government is encouraging its public to start their businesses. But in Hong Kong, you are putting an end to this kind of characteristic. Now, you have asked people to surrender hawker licenses. We only have 3,464 now, a reduction of 800 instead of 4,330 that we used to have. They are actually a very unique characteristic for Hong Kong. So why do you want to reduce their numbers? You are saying you want to better the urban environment. But then again, this is a legacy of the colonial era where you want to reduce expenditure in managing our streets. And that is why you tried to reduce the number of hawkers. This is because you wanted to spend the least money in improving the street environment. But do you really want to go on with this? Don't you want to build a platform for grassroots and young people to start their business?
We conducted an opinion survey earlier on. As much as 30% of the respondents have said that hawking is an opportunity for young people to start their own business, half of the citizens told us that we should reissue hawker licenses. Of course, we aren't asking for the previous ones to be reissued. Perhaps we can have fresh ideas. If you sell sandwiches made at your own home, must we get a food factory license that is requiring a space of over 60 meters square? Of course, for the FHD, we know that, relatively speaking, it is bureaucratic, it is rigid. The other day, we eventually got to meet the joint office on water seepage together with three other policy bureaus. I don't know why the Food and Health Bureau is allowing the Development Bureau to take the lead. In fact, the joint office would like to help the citizens. I'm afraid we haven't got a lot of positive replies. Yes, this is being looked into by the review task force. Is it really something so very difficult that we cannot get a solution? Probably not. Well, during the for the policy address, we saw a breakthrough. When compared with the previous colonial practices, I think we have got something very different. There is the Lantau Tomorrow Vision. You may say that I'm digressing too much. Yes, I accuse the government of cutting down on the costs and reducing its commitment. However, please take a look at the map. I have downloaded this map from the internet. The area shaded pink was land generated by reclamation. Madam Chair, you used to be a member of Kowloon City District Council. Well, in fact, I also live in that area, and in fact, reclamation was relied upon to solve the problem of land shortage. Now, the current government would like to count on reclamation to solve the problem of land shortage. I think what is outstanding is just one point, that is what the public would get out of it. If the government can make it clear, that is, as to what will be resulted so as to improve the quality of life, then the citizens would certainly welcome it. Say, for example, for the HOS flats on the artificial island, if it is to be sold at a rate of $2,000 per square foot, then it will be welcome, or $4,000 a square foot for land to be disposed of. Well, maybe you said that for the property housing, the unit rental rate will be $1,000 per square foot. I'm sure this can remove the doubts as well as other myths concerning reclamation. I used to grow up on reclaimed land, and even for us living in Kowloon East, for the area outside Al-Chi-wan, it was again formed by reclamation. So I think what is needed is clear explanation to the public as to what the public can gain from Lantau Tomorrow Vision. I hope the secretary can make it clear to the public. I'm sure by giving them a clear explanation, they will support you. All right, so I speak. Thank you. Dr. Fernando Cheung. Thank you, Madam Deputy. First of all, I'd like to talk about the case of the Civil Service College. Well, at first, you may think that the Civil Service College has nothing to do with labor and welfare, but it was found out that for the disabled, if they would like to have vocational training after secondary schooling, they will go to a particular skills center, and this skills center has to be relocated so as to vacate the site for the Civil Service College. Well, since the announcement on the day of the policy address, this became known to us. Shine Skills Center is a skills center set up by the Vocational Training Council. On that day, a circular was sent out to the students telling them that in the third or the fourth quarter of year 2021, the school will close. And in fact, the wording used was it would cease operation and then they have to move to somewhere else. However, no other details were given as to Port Phlegm Skills Center as well as Tuen Mun Skills Center. They will not be affected. So if the students haven't completed their course, they can go to the other two skills centers. After it has become known to the public, the secretary came out to give an explanation. He said that it's fine because it's only a matter of reprovisioning. Well, it is odd if you talk about reprovisioning or removal. When it comes to reprovisioning, it means that the school will be set up elsewhere. I talked to Mrs. Carrie Lam. I talked to Mrs. Yao, Carrie Yao, the head of the VTC. She said that she only got the written notice a short while ago, saying that in quarter four of 2021, the government will take back the site. She said that nobody told her as to where the skills center will be reprovisioned. So it is odd. You ask the center to suspend operation and the site is to be surrendered to the government. You haven't told her as to where the center will be reprovisioned. It is said that there will be an integrated training center. It will be run by the NGO under the jurisdiction of the SWD. Now, of course, the VTC isn't an NGO. The VTC is an academic institution under the government, and it is not being funded by the SWD. All the time, it is being funded by the Labour and Welfare Bureau. So I think the secretary was being hypocritic, and in fact, it isn't a matter of reprovisioning, it's a matter of closure. Now, the secretary has said that we don't need to worry, it's a matter of seamless transition. Now, if you go there in year 2020, then you will be affected. Instead of taking the course for 2 years, you can cram it into 1 year. Upon completion of the 1 year program, as to what will happen next, there isn't any information as to where it will be relocated. The secretary said that it will be even closer to the town center than the current Shine Skills Center. Again, no more details have been given. So this dragged on for a month or so, attracting a lot of appropriate attention. Well, for the young children, if the government tells a school that, sorry, in 3 years' time, your school is going to stop operation, you have to give us back your site. And it doesn't matter for those who are still studying at your school, there will be seamless transition. And if you want to squeeze 4 years' materials into 2 years' time, it's fine. What will be taught, where the school will be relocated, sorry, no information. Because I can't fabricate information to give you, because the information just doesn't exist and therefore there's nothing I can tell you. Madam Deputy, it is really odd. If you would like to redevelop a site, then first of all, you have to check those school are affected. Either they live there or they go to school there or they work there or they run a business there. So the first thing is to tell those who will be affected. You have to tell them that, yes, I've got such a plan, so what do you think? And probably you will tell them that you will be re-proficient, rehoused, relocated, you don't need to worry. But certainly those who will be affected will tell you that, well, you have got it wrong. It's impossible for me to change a two-year program into a one-year program. We are talking about disabled students, people having hearing impairment, visual impairment, intellectually disabled, mildly disabled or physically disabled, or people having autism. So you are not telling them what will happen next. You don't even show them a basic degree of respect. Do you treat them as human beings or cargo, or do they are they just second-class citizens? Now, since you would like to build a college for civil servants, and so you tell them that they should move, they should give way. So are you saying that you don't care whether the school has been there for over 50 years? Well, in fact, for civil servants, well, I know civil servants who are retired civil servants, some of them have been trained on this particular site. And for it used to be a skills center. And for the disabled students, are you treating them as second-class citizens? Are you saying that, well, I have identified this site, you have to go? As to what will happen in the future, in due course, I will give you the information. Is this the right attitude to adopt? Well, the secretary said that the policy address should be kept confidential, and therefore no information, no notification should be given. Now we are giving you a three-year notice, so you've got ample time. What else and what more would you need? Well, is that the sort of attitude that we expect in today's society? You don't even have the minimum degree of decency. Now you say that civil servants need a college, and then for the disabled, your school has to give way. Why? The government hasn't got land? Now you like this site because it's next to the Kwun Tong MTR station. It is convenient, accessible. But what about the current users? Are you saying that the disabled are not entitled to a better accessibility? You talk about a more convenient location nearer to the town center, but you're not able to disclose the specific information. Now, we are told that there will be a consultative committee on the civil service college. Now, for you to construct a college, you say that you are going to set up a consultative committee. You will sound out the views of those affected. But what about the users of the skills center? They will be kicked out, but you are not sounding them out. So your priorities have been exposed in this incident. For the disabled, well, they find it difficult to finish their course. Even upon graduation, they find it difficult to get a job. So you have to give way. Now, for civil servants, they are very important people. They have to undertake national studies programs. They have to learn about the presidency's thoughts. So you need to give way. I say it is fine, then it is fine. As to the future, I will tell you in due course. So is this a sort of new style of governance? Even as of today, we haven't got more information about this matter. All right, on the 20th, when we have the meeting of the Welfare Services Panel, we'll just see how Professor Law is going to give an account to us on this matter. Will there be more information, or is he taking another sort of stance? And then for the policy address, I think the focus is on the Lantau Tomorrow Vision. Artificial islands providing 1,700 hectares of land. It appears that it is going to make or make or break Hong Kong. It seems that this is going to be the blueprint of our future development. So it seems that our fate, our future, would depend on this grand plan, 1,700 hectares of land on the artificial islands. Do we have a roof over our heads? Can we have economic development? Are we going to find land for welfare facilities? Now, we are told that everything hinges on East Lantau Metropolis or the Lantau Tomorrow Vision. So the government is saying that the 1,000 hectare artificial island in the 2030 plus study is not good enough, and we need another 700 hectares of land.
I don't know where Carrie Lam get this vision. I don't know, I don't understand why she attaches no importance to our natural environment. It seems that the environment is ours to take. Economy is everything. We have to develop. I will create something out of nothing for development's sake. There is no alternative. The most important thing is, once I've decided, it's going to happen. Such determination. If only I can see the same determination to resolve livelihood problems. What about long-term care? Is there any vision? If you go to the street, you will find a substandard RCHEs or residential homes for people with disability. And these are the final homes of Hong Kong people. No one, no family can escape from that fate. When we get old, when we lose our productivity, for health reasons or other reasons, we can't take care of ourselves, we fall, we are hospitalized, no one's there to take care of you because everyone's busy making a living. What choices do we have? Do we have sufficient community care service to enable us to age in place? The government's been chanting the same slogan for a decade. If you can't take care of yourself, if you want to stay at home, if you don't want to go to a home, is that possible? Do we have to queue and wait for home-based service? Do we have to wait for daycare service? Do we have to wait first for assessment? And how long, how much longer do we have to wait after that? We're talking about years, if not. We're talking about months, if not years. Who is there to take care of you? Your family members have to quit their job to sacrifice, to make sacrifice. And in this way, the elderly person will think that they are a burden. Or you can go to a home or go to a hospital. That's why we have the highest hospitalization rate in the world. If you're over 65, the admission rate is 7%. You don't see that anywhere else. You are trying to fool us. Aging in place? Are you joking? More and more elderly people are admitted to hospital. But the secretary said that for subvented homes, it will take forever to be constructed. Private homes, it will be there the next day. And it accounts for 60 to 70% of all the places in Hong Kong. But there is very low quality. For the overnight shift, one staff member to six inmates. Are you going to send your mother there, secretary? Are you happy with such a standard? Sorry, it's 1 to 60, not 1 to 6. We have been fighting for an improvement. Now there is a minor amendment. I want to increase spatial requirement. I want to increase manning ratio. And it's like I was trying to rob them. The secretary makes excuses. We asked for overhaul. They said, well, we only need baby steps. But there is no review in the past 2 decades. We need an overhaul. Why would you treat elderly people like this? Where's your vision? You don't care when it comes to this area? Or the vision of the chief executive is to get 600,000 foreign domestic helpers to come here. Currently is about 300,000. So 600,000 foreign domestic helpers will solve long-term care problems. Children, those who are frail, those who are old, will be taken care of by an outsider. Or you can simply send them to China. This is an international financial center. This is a city not for the weak because it's too expensive. You now create 1,700 hectares of land in East Lantau for the weak, for PWDs? No. They said that, well, land sales will make a profit. So it is their plan to get rich, filthy rich. It's not for the underprivileged to stay there. Well, they're now going to pour $1 trillion down the drain and they will get back at the other end maybe $2 or $3 trillion. This is the same group of scholars who are opposed to universal retirement protection and supported the MPF. And now the government will have to pay about $30 billion to try to get themselves defended. They are in cahoot with one another. We are nothing to them. They only see the dollar sign. This is their vision. Let's have more foreign domestic helpers. There is a recent survey. 30% of foreign domestic helpers take care of elderly people living by themselves or with their elderly partner. That means about 100,000 people, 100,000 foreign domestic helpers that live with elderly people. Can you imagine the problems they have? Do they know how to take care of the elderly people? The administration said, now we have something new. This is a new plan. We will train foreign domestic helpers to take care of elderly people. Number of places? 300. We've done something. We have 300,000 foreign domestic helpers and 300 places to train them. And they say, we have done something. When you say, we don't have this, they said, we do, and then they give you a bare minimum. And then they say, we have done it. That's our job, and it's done. And these are senior government officials with a high salary. They told you, everything's done. We have everything in Hong Kong, but everything is short. But it's not their problem because there is limited resources and we use it for those who are in most need. Well, you can fight for it or you can draw lots. It's easy. Well, the high land price policy, low tax regime will continue. Rich people will continue to become rich. Poor people will continue to become poor. They can't get a flat. Their wage can't even catch up with inflation. And they will say, we will do as much as possible. I think that's the catchphrase of Matthew Jung. We will do as best as we can. Everything will be targeted. All discipline services are very professional. So the government can do no wrong. They have done everything. But only superficially. And they talk about importation of labor. And that's what the policy address says. What are you talking about? We have an acute manpower shortage. So you want to import labor. Did you not think about what wages you offer them? You now said, well, we'll give carers two more incremental points, and if it's proved that they can still have recruitment problems, then there will be import of labor. The money doesn't go to staff members. We have received a lot of complaints because the money has gone to line pockets of the management. Do you know what these imported labor we have to work in what kind of environment? About a dozen of them in a home recently bravely came out to speak about the problem they have. We try to find another job for these imported labor. They are all gone. They're charged 20,000 yuan by an agency, so they're in debt. It's just like the 300,000 foreign domestic helpers. They pay a market wage, but they have to give back the same amount of money, $3,000, to their debtor. And they are not allowed to have vacation leaves, maybe two or three times to go back to their homeland just for two or three days. They work, if necessary, round the clock, and they don't have Saturdays or Sundays off. I heard that in some homes, two people will have to share the same bed because they work in shifts. So you will, it's your bed for the first 12 hours and it's mine for the next 12. And they have these shadow staff members. You don't know what that is. Well, that is the number they've reported, but they don't actually have that many. When there is a license check, they make phone calls, and all these phantom ones will have to come to pretend to work. Of course, the secretary knows full well about it. The social welfare department conducts 7 or 8 inspections a year. They know full well what is going on, but they want to tolerate it. They want to just let it continue. They are very tolerant when elderly people are tied to their beds. Some scholars in the Hong Kong U Polytechnic University published a journal about how many elderly people are constrained in homes. 70% in subvented homes, they're restrained to different degrees. I can send you the journal. For private homes, can you imagine how much worse it is? I can tell you that for residential homes, for PWDs, is much worse than RCHEs. We have discovered some cases. They are tied to their beds when they're awake, when they're asleep, or even when they are going to the toilet. I go everywhere. Some homes refuse my entry. They look at me and know that comeuppance is at their door. I have to queue for my daughter because you have to wait for 17 years. I will be 78 then. I don't know what my health condition will be. If I don't start getting in the queue, then I'll be irresponsible. I will not send my daughter to a home. But I don't know when I will die. I don't know when I will be unable to take care of my daughter. I live in Hong Kong, and this is the situation. That's tragic. If one day I lost the ability to take care of myself, I am demented, like Professor Cao, the late Professor Cao. I don't know whether I can afford a private home. It will cost you $500 a day. And so far, the administration continues to refuse to set up day care centers for dementia patients.
I don't know whether I should queue up for a home. I don't want to go to a home. But I also know that if I don't go into a home, my family members will have the difficult task of taking care of me. If not, should I get an FDH? Do FDHs know how to take care of people? Why are Hong Kong people in such a distraught condition? We are so affluent. We can build an artificial island of 1,700 hectares in the middle of the sea, and yet we don't have money to tackle these basic needs. And I'm not even talking about drugs for cancer patients and patients with rare diseases. And that is some kind of basic medical service. We are so regressed, and people have a revisit only years after the first visit. If you want an MRI CAT scan in order to do diagnosis of your condition, people wait for years for that. And how many people can wait that long and you have to go to the private sector? What about those who don't have the means? So sorry, you just wait. Why are we in such a situation? What are your priorities? What's wrong with those? Are you dreaming day after day? Today, our elderly, the disabled are suffering, and the sick are suffering. If you need target medicine, if you need expensive drugs, well, sorry, we will have to wait for the whim of the CE if she will say that SMA patients are children, so she shows them sympathy, then they have the drug. What about the rest? Wait. Madam Deputy, whether we are talking about the elderly, and then dental service or long-term care, basic care for the disabled, if you look at existing services, just look at my daughter and these skill training centers, you have and we are talking about people who have graduated from special schools in 2009, 2010. They are waiting 8 years to go to a day center. And talking about residential places, people wait over a decade. But the Hong Kong-Zhuhai-Macau Bridge has broken world records. It's a grand project. We have XLL, we have the third runway, we have an artificial island. All these are record-breaking infrastructural projects. But the weakest, the frail, and the old, they are waiting for basic services. And also, that is breaking world record. I have never seen people having to wait for over 10 years for some public service. Madam Deputy, Dr. C.K. Law is really smart. He says if you want to make haste, the more you have to wait. And he is pretending to solve the problem just by talking about it. And he is telling us that we should be prepared to wait. And he would have done his job. Let us look forward to the Lantau Tomorrow Vision. We hope that 1 or 2 hectares will be taken back from the 1,700 hectares so we can benefit the old and the disabled. And let them be under restraint. Let them be cared for with a ratio of 1 to 60. Mr. KWOK Ka-ki, thank you, Madam Deputy. The third session. is on improving people's livelihood. If we want to do that, we must do the following. We must have love, we must have responsibility, we must have a vision, and we must do it in a timely manner. The SAR government gives people the general impression that it reacts slowly. I'm not talking only about this term of government, but all these terms of governments in the SAR, and they have been discussing without making a decision. They have made a decision without acting. And I'm targeted in my criticism. Talk about housing, INT, environment protection, talent nurturing. We are still catching up. We are not a pioneer in the international arena. If we want to improve people's livelihood, you really need to play the lead. Our SARG has always gone by the principle of a big market and a small government. But if you always rely on the market, you'd rather pray, because the principle of a market is to make profits. It is not there to solve problems for the community. The spirit of the market is clear, but what about the spirit of the government? As I was saying, you should have love, responsibility, vision, and you should do things in a timely manner. With regard to Lantau tomorrow, the PA is saying that there is a social cost to play. And in fact, it serves to solve a long-standing problem, and it has vision because it is looking into 20 years ahead, and so it's worth our support. I'd like to talk about e-cigarettes. I was the first one to raise a question on e-cigarettes in the council. And I like to describe the entire process as really heart-rending. Back in 2014, when I raised it, in 2015, the Bureau mentioned that there should be a complete ban. Well, that was what the government said at the beginning. I'm trying to be fair to you. And then our councillors asked, do you have the information? Have you done any laboratory tests? You were enthusiastic. You said you read WHO reports and you proposed a complete ban. But we asked you for other supporting material, and then you did not produce anything. At that time, there were no heat but not burn cigarettes, but there were only e-cigarettes. And then we asked you to dig up information, and then it took you 3 years. Until 2018, and then you supplied the information, and you said you would go for some degree of control instead of a complete ban. So it gives people the impression that you changed tack. And in these 3 years, e-cigarettes have thrived. They are sold in stationery shops, and those who target the adult market are operating shops. They are like supermarkets. They are offering different flavors. Some have already signed tenancy agreements. Some have stocked up. Now it is very difficult for you to regulate them. I don't know whether, like playing basketball, you were playing a sleight of hand to trick the opposition camp. If that's your purpose, then you have achieved your purpose, because now the opposition camp asked you for a complete ban, and you're saying you want to issue a complete ban, and they have no room for maneuver. They must support you. But I told you, time is the most important thing. You must do things in a timely manner, because so much has happened in the last 3 years. E-cigarettes are all over the place, and now we have heat-not-burn cigarettes. The CE is now snapping a complete ban on e-cigarettes. From the angle of medical and health, of course, it would be most ideal. But since you did not act in time, you are setting up barriers for yourselves. I was referring to the market, and I was referring to business activities that are already taking place. I hope you will overcome those barriers. You have done a good job in controlling tobacco in the last 30 years. The smoking population has come down. But then if there are new products, there will be new smokers. And you must come clean on that. I hope that the Bureau will not take us on a roller coaster anymore. You started with complete ban and then some kind of control and then complete ban. please do not delay legislation anymore, because the more you delay, the bigger the barrier is. I hope you will legislate for the complete ban as soon as possible. I'd like to talk about welfare portability in the PA. You mentioned that the Fujian and Guangdong schemes only cover OH allowance. Starting from 2013, we started to have the OH living allowance, and the FTU already said that OALA should be included in the Guangdong and Fujian schemes. The PA mentioned that, but then when are you going to implement it? You have the system there, and I don't think anybody would want to benefit from the OALA by going back to the mainland. You know, our country is developing by leaps and bounds, and the living index is also going up all the time. If you do not improve the lot of Hong Kong elderly people who have moved back to the mainland so that they can enjoy the enhanced OALA, there will be no protection for their quality of life when they live on the mainland. I hope you will do this quickly. I must also mention, as other members have said, that elderly services are not just about money, but they should be services. You are slow in building government homes, and you are talking about looking for land, and you trace every problem back to the issue of land. Okay, I know you don't have a magic wand, you can't resolve it overnight, but now you know very well that there is a gross shortage of elderly services and beds. You should launch more supplementary measures. Many people mentioned aging in place. What have you done? Is it enough? Are you poised to resolve the problem because the aging population is increasing? I hope you will show some vision. There are many livelihood issues you have to tackle. There are many aspirations. That is your job. It's your job to face up to these aspirations and solve problems. I therefore would emphasize again that the SARG should show the public that you have stamina and your love for the community, your responsibility, your vision, and that you will act in a timely manner so that our city will really become a livable city. In the next session, Madam Deputy, I will speak more on housing and other aspects of life, because we are going to talk about a livable city. I'll stop here in this session. Mr. Roy Kwong.